gonna be round my vegetables. I'm gonna chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you'd toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back. Hi, Ken. Hi, Vivien.
Hi.
How are you?
Hello. Hello. Am I unmuted now?
You are.
Great. Nice to meet you, Elaine.
You too. I'm so glad I saw you were both on watching the art. Wasn't that fantastic?
Oh my God.
Awesome.
It was amazing.
Thank you for inviting them. Thank you for finding them. It was great.
Mind blowing. I will connect you with them, Ken. But until then, I'm really excited to talk about this project that you guys have going on.
We're awesome too, hopefully. Not as awesome as these guys, maybe, but you know, we'll do our best.
You're talking about, okay. Yakteen, is that how you pronounce it?
Yakteen, yeah.
A beloved edible gourd from Palestine. I've never heard of this. Very excited about it. I'm just going to give a little intro to you guys first, and then I'm going to give you hand over the control for you to share your screen and do the presentation and tell us about this. It's fantastic. So this is a partnership between the Palestine Heirloom Seed Library, which is Vivien, who's with us, and Ken Greene, who is with, he does so many things. He is Hudson Valley Seed Company and Seed Shed. They're focused on this this edible gourd, and it grew, the project grew simultaneously, and or they grew the gourd simultaneously in Palestine as well as a Hudson Valley that's in New York, on comparing the growth, yield, flavor, and viability of the variety in these two very different growing regions and climates. It's also a seed solidarity partnership, recognizing the ongoing threats to land and agriculture faced in Palestine, the impact on traditional seeds, and the inaccessibility of Palestinian and Middle Eastern varieties in the States. Ken, I told you, is the founder of the first seed library in the United States that has grown into the Hudson Valley Seed Company now, that he runs with his partner Doug up in Hudson Valley. And they are a national seed company and regional seed farm that's devoted to ethically producing seed for home gardeners and farmers and celebrating seeds through art. Today, Ken Greene is the founder and director of Seed Shed, which is a nonprofit organization focused on growing regional and cultural seed communities through seed literacy and seed justice programs. I'm taking the time to read these because you guys do so much and I want people to know about it, and it's limited time. So I'm going to read the whole thing that you guys sent. So, and Vivien Sansour is an artist, a storyteller, a researcher, and a conservationist. She uses image, sketch, film, soil, seeds, and plants to enliven old cultural tales and contemporary presentations and to advocate for seed conservation and protection of agro biodiversity as a cultural and political act. Vivien founded the Palestine Heirloom, this work with local farmers, and has been showcased internationally. She was born in Jerusalem and lives in both Bethlehem as well as Los Angeles. I am so happy to have you guys here and to talk about this super cool project. I'm gonna go ahead and let you guys take it away. You know people are watching on YouTube because you just did it.
Are we live already?
You're live, girl.
Yeah. Oh my God. I'm like, what is this? She's doing a really extensive rehearsal.
This is it. You just come in and we just go.
We are here. We're here.
I like it. I learned to jump in, so it's good. Thank you.
About it. Sorry, there's no warning. We just go.
Hey, so I like it. Now,
you guys know one another. And so, yeah, take it away. Let us, you know, take the screen if you want, share with us right here, whatever you like. And I'll ask you questions when you guys are done presenting.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Lane. Thanks for inviting us to share. I'm gonna do a screen share. We're gonna go through some slides and a few little video snippets. And we're trying to keep that around 15 minutes, I think, so that we have time for Q&A. So I'm just gonna share. So is that looking good?
That looks good.
All right. So thank you for the introductions. We're gonna skip doing our own introductions because I think that was great. And we are here to talk about Yakteen. So Vivien, do you wanna do a quick introduction to the plant that we're all meeting today?
Yeah, first I wanna say thank you, Lane, and thank you so much, Ken. I'm really excited to speak about Yakteen because it is the first time, at least, that we get to talk about the story of this very beloved mother that we love so much in Palestine. Yakteen, you know, we grow up with it as kind of the most regular thing you eat in the summer. This particular picture is exactly how, you know, typically we eat it. It is cored and stuffed with usually meat and rice. It can also be done in a vegetarian style. But it is a very much the vegetable that declares summer is here in Palestine. And we love it so much. And so it's really wonderful to be able to share it with the rest of the world through sharing its seeds.
Yeah, thanks, Vivien. And thank you for sharing this. I know that, you know, when we talk about varieties, sometimes we can, you know, lean into the scientific part or the botanical part. And it's important to remember that varieties are really rooted in culture, and that there's more to thinking about a food or a variety than just what we can do in terms of breeding or how it's grown or how we eat it. But I do just want to add in a little bit of some background information for folks who are curious about the family. So this is Legendaria caesararia. So if you're familiar with kukuzi or guguts or bottle gourds, that's all the same species. And so my introduction to this plant was actually through kukuzi because that's related to some of my ancestry and culture. And it was really wonderful to meet the Yakteen, sort of the mother of all of that plant family through Vivien's eyes and Vivien's experience. And Vivien, you shared with me once something that like a saying about planting?
Yes, so in Palestine in general, our traditional method of agriculture doesn't just involve the soil, but also involves the soul. So whenever we put a seed in the ground, we say, may we eat and be able to share, to feed others. And I love this very much as part of my indigenous culture because as I was planting more with farmers, you know, I got to say it more and I got to understand what it really means in a bigger level. So how when we are also choosing crops to plant, we're also choosing a certain way of being, literally. And I like this picture that Ken chose to share, not the part where I'm in it, but the part where the Yakteen here, it is climbing into our fig tree. This is in my garden. And it really kind of represents this convivio that we have, you know. It's not just a community of people that interact together and live and coexist together, but also it's a plant culture and how, you know, as we all know, listening to this, I imagine, you know, most people here understand that seeds exist within a system, within a system of knowledge also. These are some of our terraces in the village of Battir in Palestine. Battir is a village in the Bethlehem district. And it's actually a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And these terraces that you're looking at are really as ancient as pre-Roman times. And until today, we still use the same irrigation system from, again, pre-Roman times, which is why it was granted UNESCO World Heritage Site. But again, this irrigation system doesn't live all these literally generations if it weren't for the collaboration between the people in the community. And it's a, I can explain it, it's a more elaborate thing in another time when we have more time, but I wanted to show with Ken this picture because the Yakteen actually is used to, it climbs on all these ancient terraces and it provides a lovely kind of a canvas, you know, of a painting on all these ancient terraces. And it hangs basically all summer throughout the fall. And this is how, you know, it hangs like lanterns and people get to enjoy it. But it's also a fantastic companion plant to other summer crops. So actually, at least in our little microclimate, we have noticed that when we grow the Yakteen, it helps protect other summer crops from getting diseases, such as the tomatoes and the okras and the zucchinis. So it's a super wonderful companion plant. And it produces very beautiful flowers. This is an image actually from my family home in Palestine, in our little town. You're looking at Bethlehem here from this angle. This is through our ancient grapevines. And this is one of the last remaining terraces in our town. And that's because, as you can see, we're surrounded by a segregation wall. We live in a segregated system, and Palestinians are shoved into basically now these open air prisons. And so we are severed from our agricultural terrains. And you know, when we are planting this Yakteen and other ancient varieties, it is truly an act of resistance to our own eradication as an indigenous community. And so this is one of the last, like I said, remaining terraces that we're trying to salvage and protect as a safe haven for the Yakteen and other heirloom varieties, which is, by the way, a project that is in development now to turn it into a public trust and safe haven for a biohabitat. And if people are interested to learn more about it or support it, I would love if you contact me. This is another image of our terracing system in the village of Batir. Again, here I just want to say we don't call these terraces terraces. We call them Jnan, and Jenni in Arabic means paradise. So you say, where are you going? You say, I'm going to the paradise. And it's, you know, it's just, this poetry is in the language because, as you can see, it is a, this is just a snippet of it, and it's a, it's truly a paradise.
And so this partnership meant that the Yakteen got to grow in the Hudson Valley, Lenape, Haudenosaunee, and Mohican land. And we didn't really know how the Yakteen was going to respond. It's a very different climate, different soils, definitely a different amount of water in terms of the amount of rain and the way that the soil holds the water, a much shorter season than what it's used to. You know, our frosts are between the end of May and, you know, we have basically from the end of May until October to grow. So it's a much shorter season. So it was a real act of like leap of faith in many ways to say, all right, what happens when the Yakteen comes to the Hudson Valley and we grow it? We didn't really know exactly how it was going to go.
Yeah, I love this picture because in our journey together with the Hudson Valley also, we got to speak a lot, Ken and I, about what community means and seeds living in community, and also about the community that we are creating together for this future. You know, we talk about not just climate change, but social justice, political justice, the world we're living in today. And then the pandemic was also going on. And we both love this picture so much for two main reasons. One is actually in this picture, it's there. We have a guest here, a dear friend, Stephen Wooten. He is from Oregon and he's a food guy and he teaches about food science. But anyway, he was visiting us here and we went down with my colleagues and farmer friends. We went down in the paradises to look for that day Yakteen seeds. And as you can see, you know, it's like you go, you walk around in the valley and through the terraces and suddenly it becomes a time to have a cup of coffee together. And then you kind of ask permission to get a big gourd. And that's how people exchange seeds. When we talk about seed exchanges, it just happens so organically. You literally pick it off the vine that's drying and you take it home. And it's a gift that you give to your neighbors and to your friends with no calculations. And for me, that is also a big important part of keeping seeds and keeping seeds alive through these relationships as well. Also highlighted by how, you know, we also exchange seeds when we, like we did here.
And this is some of the community that helped grow the Yakteen in the Hudson Valley. So some of the team members from Seed Shed. And in the middle there is actually Mary Arquette, who is one of our seed partners from the Mohawk community in Akwesasne. So there was a lot of story exchange and you know, a lot of different perspectives and experiences of growing and what seeds mean, all interacting with the Yakteen. And it's hard not to pick up a large Yakteen and not feel like you're holding a child. It's just sort of what your body naturally wants to do when you pick it up is to cradle her.
That's funny because I feel like it cradles me. I feel like I'm carrying a mother. I mean, I'm in her arms, not it's in my arms.
So hopefully this will work. We're going to see a little bit of video of Vivien in her garden at home in Palestine.
So this year we were so happy, or actually, yeah, this year, to make friends with the Hudson Valley.
Hey, Ken, I'm not sure if this would help, but did you share your screen and optimize for video? There's a little button on the bottom when you share a screen.
No.
Might be worth just pausing real quick and then try and reshare and click those buttons just so we can hear the audio a little bit better.
So where should I stop sharing and reshare?
Yep, stop share and then it's
all right, everybody, we're gonna do a little technical thing. So stop share and then
also hi, I'm Abba behind the
scenes.
Hi Abba.
Hello, I'm so loving this. I just want them to be able to hear you. So if you reshare share screen, and then on the bottom left it's an optimize for video clip and share sound. There are two little boxes.
Yeah.
And if you click those, then we should be able to hear it a little bit better.
All right, I'm gonna back this Thank you. Up and see.
Reinforced by our collaboration to bring the Yakteen variety, which I'm gonna show.
It sounds so much better.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, great, let's try it.
So this year we were so happy, or actually it was this year, to make friends with the Hudson Valley Seed Library, and particularly with Ken Greene, the founder of the Hudson Valley Seed Library. And it's been a gorgeous friendship that has really kept my heart pretty strong this year. And it has been reinforced by our collaboration to bring the Yakteen variety, which I'm going to show you here. The Palestinian Yakteen. To the Hudson Valley Seed Library collection. So we worked together, we commissioned a young Palestinian artist, and she has created an art packet for our seeds
that will be sold with the Hudson Valley Seed Library and Seed Shed. And we planted basically so much of this Yakteen, Seed Shed did, in Hudson Valley, New York. And so it has taken apparently a couple of acres, because as you can see, it takes over, it took over this old almond tree. And so we eat it usually when it's a baby, but here we call this lovely Yakteen the Rabbaye. And Rabbaye means basically the mother, because inside the belly of this gorgeous creature are hundreds of Yakteen seeds that will actually become hundreds of Yakteen plants next year. And so we keep the mother on the vine until it completely dries up and it becomes a brown, and it becomes like a shaker. You can hear the, when it's totally dry and you can hear the seeds inside, that means it's ready to ripen. So again, emphasizing the power and beauty of having relationships with each other, and also of basically our plants being our mothers and us being seeds ourselves. So this is one of the millions of amazing mothers in the world. This is the Yakteen I was telling you about when it dries. This is a dried one from last year. And you can hear inside all the babies. So this year,
so am I still with you?
Yes.
Because I can't see anyone anymore. But I will just play this next clip. So this next clip is going to show the Yakteen growing in the Hudson Valley.
As you can see, it has taken over the Hudson Valley.
So that's just a little bit of drone footage of the field, which we had no idea it was going to do this. That was about 200 plants that you're looking at there.
But just to say, the reason it did, we think, so crazy, went so wild in the Hudson Valley. I mean, it is a plant that grows and climbs, but in the Hudson Valley, it went really nuts. And as Ken once said, I think he, you know, it was maybe so thirsty, because it is a plant that does require irrigation, and we have a lot of plants that don't in Palestine. But the amount of rain and sun that it probably got in the Hudson Valley is probably a whole lot more, especially that we actually do not have any rain in the summer. And in the Hudson Valley, it was raining all summer and having sunshine. So it was interesting to see kind of when it was able to drink a whole lot, what it was able to do.
Lane, how are we on time? I feel like, should we? Oh, you're on mute.
Thank you. It was about 7 minutes, 6 minutes, and nobody has written any questions, but people are really loving it and saying it's absolutely beautiful and also emotional for them. So you can keep going. I wanted to comment that looks like kudzu. He takes over and becomes an ocean of the vine. But you can just keep going if you like.
All right. So Vivien, we have about 6 minutes.
Okay.
So we're going to go through some of these slides a little bit quickly.
Yeah, just very quickly. This is an image from my kitchen table. Just to say that, you know, the best way to harvest it is when it's very young, very small. And that's when you peel it. It's so soft and easy to peel. But then, you know, you really want to harvest it at this time, because that's when it's tender. You can either stuff it or saute it or whatever. When it grows to the bigger, it's kind of, it gets harder. You will just have to saute it, but it's not as good, to be honest, in terms of flavor. This is obviously another group of yakteen swimming in tomato sauce. Again, it's really a staple dish in Palestine. And here it is. This is a very simple recipe. Obviously, we use a lot of olive oil. We have a Mediterranean climate and diet. So you can't go wrong with sauteing a bit of garlic or onion and putting it in there with some tomatoes, with rice. It's fantastic. Yeah, so.
Vivien, do you guys use the vines, like with the kookoosa? The vine is often used.
Yeah, no, rarely actually in terms of cuisine, but yakteen is considered a medicinal plant also in traditional Arab medicine. And so it's considered an antioxidant and anti-inflammatory and all of these things. So people do recommend it often for, especially its water as a healing crop.
So these are the seeds. For folks who've never seen gourd seeds before, they're really cool shapes. One of the first things, we started them early here in the Hudson Valley, got a head start. We transplanted them in late May. We got a really late frost in like early June. And I came to the field that morning and I thought that they were all dead. I mean, they were just so burned, most of them down to nothing, even though we had them covered in row cover. So they are very sensitive to frost, but they all bounced back. This is the tunnel, you know, with these open fields, we don't have trees or fences or other natural things for them to climb. So we created these trellises and they just took off after bouncing back from that frost and just started covering everything. And there are all these moments during the season, you know, Vivien was in Palestine and we were in the garden here in the Hudson Valley and we just stayed very, very connected. When we do this type of work where we're growing a variety that is very embedded in a culture, it's important to us to really follow the guidance and the leadership of the home community. So there was just so much reaching back and forth in this moment in the garden reminded me of Vivien and I continually reaching out to each other across a pretty vast expanse to talk about what was happening in the garden, how were things doing, sending pictures, doing little videos back and forth. And one of the things that was happening was Vivien kept saying, where are the flowers? Where are the flowers? Where are the flowers? Because it just kept growing more, like the biomass was so intense and it wasn't blooming. And finally it started flowering. The flowers are just exquisite.
Yeah, he would send me pictures of it, like all these foliage, and I was freaking out, like, where? I don't see a flower. Where is the flower? So our first flower was quite a momentous moment.
And then we started finding little immature fruits. They're like cute and fuzzy, like peach fuzzy. The yakteen also has a really distinct scent, which some people like and some people don't like. Pretty strong. And then at the stage when it was at its first edible stage, Vivien had asked us to mail a few.
My parents live in North Carolina. And so they often obviously miss their home and miss the flavor of home. So when I told my mom that a friend is growing yakteen in New York, she freaked out. She's like, send me some, you know? And so Ken was so nice. These are the first two little fruits and he sent them in the mail with other seeds to my mother. And it was a really beautiful moment because she got to taste a little bit of home. And it was this amazing kind of route that the yakteen took in order to sort of return home to the bodies that it was also familiar with. And that was a beautiful moment, obviously, for me and my mother to share about a love of yakteen.
I'm gonna go through these really fast. these, you know, simultaneous moments that Vivien and I had in the garden, in our respective gardens, touching the plants and talking to each other. This is how the tunnel started to fill in our garden. It just kept going and going and going. And we kept looking for the fruits. And then I would send Vivien a photo of a fruit in our garden, and she would send one of the fruit at home in Palestine.
Yeah, and just to note the difference between, like, obviously this one is in Palestine, also because this is it's not as crazy in terms of how many leaves there are. It doesn't drink as much, but also this is in the backyard of someone's house. And Yakteen is used to create canopies and shaded areas. So even in urban spaces, planting Yakteen, we have people planting it even in the refugee camps, because it does provide a kind of shelter from the sun. And it's also a lovely, gorgeous thing to sit under and have a cup of tea. And of course, it provides food. This is my dear friend and partner, Aid Arafe. He is a wonderful painter and artist. And this was our first harvest when we first started the Palestine Heirloom Seed Library. Sorry, there's a lot of noise outside. And he's wearing a t-shirt of recipes that his mom gave him, that he drew himself. So we started to also again engage art and agriculture, and seeds were a wonderful way to engage that. And also, you know, people of course can, if they like, follow his designs. It's they're based after his destroyed village that they were forced out of. So he comes from agricultural heritage, but they were severed from it, and he was born and raised in the refugee camp. So for him to be able to come and touch it was an amazing moment. And now he has a design project. People can follow it on Instagram, called Qastina.designs, Qastina.designs. So it's all about recipes and other aprons and stuff. But anyway, this was, Ken and I both love this picture, and I love this man. So it was a perfect picture to use.
And Lane, I think, is our time up? Should I just go through pretty quickly?
Yes, you can just go through quickly. That would be great.
Okay.
This is so beautiful.
This is the back and forth between the gardens. We also had a lot of windstorms, and everything got so heavy, we had to create a structure inside the structure that we built, and then we had to fortify that structure so it wouldn't get blown over. This is, you know, basically in the height of the season, and just this feeling through the whole season that Vivien was with us in the garden, even though, especially because of COVID, she couldn't actually leave Palestine. The first light frost came. It is super frost sensitive. And so it got touched, and we just started covering with row cover and extending the season as much as we could to protect the fruits and get to this stage, which is how they were looking at Vivien's, so that we could harvest the seeds. And this, the patterns and patina that forms on the Yakteen when it's drying is gorgeous. And probably can't hear it because I didn't optimize for this one, but we love shaking them and hearing the seeds. And where this has wound up was, like Vivien was saying, we commissioned artwork from a young woman, Palestinian artist, so that the seeds could be released in the United States and be available for Palestinians and others in the US to have this beautiful food and grow it in their own home gardens.
Yeah, if I just may say a little bit about Haya, the artist, Haya Qabbani, she's from Jericho, and it was really exciting. I never actually met her in person because of COVID, but we got to speak on the phone a lot. And in the beginning, she was like, oh, I'm not so into agriculture. By the time she finished this beautiful depiction of really reflecting this mother, Yakteen, I now notice that all over her Facebook, she's posting things about vegetables. And so actually within engaging this young, talented artist, we experienced the transformation that can happen through the story of seeds, where she's now really excited about her own bioculture and how she's engaging it with her own art. And I loved so much what she did for us here.
And we are currently sold out. The letters that we've been getting and the emails we've been getting about what this variety means to people, it's just been incredible to get that kind of feedback about not only being able to eat a food that reminds you of home and tastes like home and as a piece of home, but also that the story is being shared through Vivien, and to be able to talk about Palestine and what's happening in Palestine and the impact on the culture and the people and the agriculture is something that we're getting a lot of really heartfelt and passionate feedback about. So it's been a very moving experience for us to be part of this and to learn both the beautiful and delicious parts of this story and also some of the very upsetting and tragic pieces of this story as well.
Oh, just to say that there's now a waiting list. Can you explain that people want the variety?
Yeah, so you can still go to the Hudson Valley Seed Company website to the variety listing, and then you can enter your email. We have germ tests on 4 more lots right now. We're just waiting for the germ test to come in. And so then as soon as new seeds are packed, anyone who's put their email in will get a little note saying that there's more Yakteen available.
Yeah, and hopefully this summer we can share a cooking demonstration live with folks, and we'll let people know. They can follow us on our social media platforms.
Yes. Lane, so sorry we went over time.
That's amazing. I mean, I don't even have anything else to say at all. You said it all. You just said it so beautifully, Ken. Thank you so much, Vivien, for sharing this with us, because this is the really important thing, I feel like, of what we're trying to do in the seed world is like share about culture and be more connected with one another through food in this way and supporting one another. So this has been a really, it's such a special partnership that you guys have, and I hope to see more of this from you guys. To peek into like this world that we don't know very much about through its wild vine that takes over everything. I can't wait to grow it in my yard. I can see that others are really inspired by it and very moved and touched that you have shared this with us here today. Thank you so much.
Thanks,
Lane. Thanks, Vivien.
Thanks, everyone.
I'm gonna be round my vegetables, I'm gonna chow down my vegetables. I love you most of all, my favorite vegetable. If you brought a big brown bag of them home, I'd jump up and down and hope you toss me a carrot. I'm gonna keep well my bed.
Hi, Josh. Oop, you're on mute.
Hi, Lane, how are you?
Great, thank you for your patience.
Oh my gosh, no problem. I'm sure you, like, do you really expect me to present after those amazing presentations that we just had? Like, I just wanna look at beautiful artwork of vegetables and talk more about Yakteen, who, you know, like, this is our new tomato variety.
No. Extremely exciting too. It is a little overwhelming, all of it, you know?
It's great though.
It is very great. And don't, no worries. I mean, as long as you don't have anything to do, you know, we're the last speaker, we can go on longer and people still hang out. Don't worry.
No, I am not worried at all.
Okay. So super excited to have Josh here today for you guys that are watching. Josh Kirschenbaum is, he lives in Chicago, works for PanAmerican Seed Company, and he is going to talk to us today about Marzito. Is this how you pronounce it?
Marzito.
Marzito. Which is a mini San Marzano tomato that they just came out with. And it's bred by Jim Irvine. He's going to show us we have a video, and Jim's on the video too. And I'm just going to let the video talk about exactly what it is. But I just want to say that I appreciate you so much, Josh, for you're always here. You come all the way here to the West Coast. We have field days. You've always participated in the Variety Showcase and brought super great stuff. And with, you know, your partner and chef, you guys are always, you're just like extremely involved in all of this and with CBN work, and I am very supportive of it and always sponsors these events, and I really do appreciate you very much. Well,
we certainly appreciate you very much, so thank you. It's a wonderful group to get to work with.
Great, thank you. Okay, we're gonna turn off our videos and mute ourselves. We're gonna watch your video. People are gonna chat in some, someone mentioned nice earrings. Yep, I wore my tomato earrings for you.
Very appropriate, thank you.
and then we'll ask questions and talk about this after the video.
Perfect. Hi everyone, I am Josh Kirschenbaum from PanAmerican Seed Company, and I'm here with my colleagues, Chenny Filios and Jim Irvine today. And we are going to have a discussion about our breeding work on tomato varieties suited for growing in high tunnels. Before we get started on that, and before I introduce you to my colleagues, I just wanted to give a little bit of an introduction about PanAmerican Seed. We are one of the world's leading flower seed breeding companies. And within the past 10 years or so, we've really put in a lot of energy into breeding vegetable varieties suited for fresh market farmers as well as home gardeners. So Chenny and Jim, do you want to say hello and introduce yourselves and what you do for the company?
Sure. I'm Chenny Filios, and I'm the product manager for vegetables. So I work between the breeding team and sales and marketing to help bring some of the great new varieties to market.
And I'm Jim Irvine. I've been with the company for 13 years, the last nearly 10, working on tomato and basil breeding. So the old joke is I'm the company's resident bruschetta breeder.
Mm-hmm. All right. So Chenny, why don't we just start out by telling why we decided to focus some of our breeding efforts on tomato varieties suitable for high tunnels?
Yeah. So over the course of about 10 years that we've been working with the handpicked vegetable group, we've seen an increased interest in growing in high tunnels, especially in northern climates, for season extension. And it's a really great way to be able to bring in tomatoes before the season starts in the field, and then extend after the season ends and the frost starts to come on. But there's some unique challenges with breeding for high tunnels. You're using the same soil year after year to grow those tomatoes in. And it's a really high humidity environment because you have usually a plastic tunnel that you're growing inside in. So really great to be able to extend season, but also some unique challenges.
Yeah. I think another nice feature of growing in high tunnels is that you can kind of control the amount of moisture that gets onto the foliage and that type of stuff too, but you do have those other challenges. And so that kind of leads me to my next question for Jim. What are the specific traits that you're looking for when you're breeding a variety suited for growing in a high tunnel?
So, you know, a major focus for everything the handpicked breeds is flavor, first and foremost. So that's, you know, a very important characteristic. But specific to high tunnels, the culture is dramatically different than a field grown tomato, primarily in how the plants are pruned and supported. You know, you think of tomato, you think of a nice big bush, right? If you've seen protected culture tomatoes, they're typically on a single or double leader, so only one growing tip is allowed to grow. And that has huge implications. So breeding for, you know, smaller internode length, so you get the most out of your space, and vine longevity, how long that those, you know, vines are going to be going, and the truss structure, because if you're only growing one, allowing one growing tip to grow, then the truss, the inflorescence that turns into the tomatoes, that structure is a really big factor of your yield, as is internode length. So those are some very interesting ones. And then of course, disease resistance, as Chenny alluded to, with the higher humidity, it has its own unique disease challenges. So it's different than in the field, and you can protect from some diseases, but you're more prone to others.
So what are some of the specific disease resistances that you're focused on for High Tunnel?
Leaf molds, powdery mildews are the major ones that are really more present in protected culture in general.
Got it. Nice. And so then I'm also wondering, is there a difference between a variety that you've been breeding for High Tunnel production versus like a greenhouse variety for, a high-tech greenhouse?
Sure. They're very similar in terms of how the plants are pruned and the expectations out of those plants, with two key differences. The first is that in a high-tech greenhouse, typically you're growing essentially hydroponically or actually hydroponically and able to change out your media. So the root zone is typically sterile, and you can get some root zone issues, but for the most part, that's more controllable. And so resistance to root zone diseases is less important. But in a high tunnel, especially since you're going back into that same soil year after year, root zone diseases become much more important. So Fusarium, Verticillium, to all the races become much, much more important. The other aspect of that is that in a high-tech greenhouse, usually those producers are harvesting a single crop for 9 to 10 months. So earliness is a very small part of that equation for them, because they're getting so much return off of a single planting. Whereas a high tunnel grower is really growing to try and extend their season and capitalize on those higher prices earlier in the season. Nobody wants to buy tomatoes in August when their backyard is producing, like crazy.
If they have a backyard.
That's correct. Yeah, that's true.
But we do have a bunch of container varieties of tomatoes as well. So there's plenty of options for people.
I was going to say, our handpicked catalog can satisfy everyone here. So they're really trying to get on that shoulder season. So they're trying to plant as early as they can, and then plant, those variety earliness becomes much more important. So that's a different emphasis that you'd be doing in high tunnels versus high-tech protected culture.
Got it. And then as someone who works on the sales and marketing side of it, I am extremely excited that we have a few varieties now that are slotted into this category. Chenny, would you like to talk a little bit about the specifics on the varieties and what they are?
Yeah. So I'll throw up a couple pictures here so we can all enjoy this together. So some of the varieties that Jim has brought to market include Artemis Tomato. And this variety is a nice, beautiful red round cherry. And it has that awesome truss like Jim was talking about. So lots of fruit that mature in a very short period of time. And some of the most unique things about this variety and why we decided to bring it to market are the flavor. It is super sweet, and it has this really unique crunchy texture. So it's like a burst in your mouth when you bite down. So it's awesome for salads. And then if you saute it, it kind of splits the skin. So you get this really juicy sauce if you want to do a quick sauce with it. And then as Jim mentioned, disease resistance, this has really great resistance for the high tunnel with leaf mold, nematode, and then a tobacco mosaic virus resistance. So great for the soils as well as foliar resistance. And then as Jim mentioned, really quick to mature, 50 to 55 days from transplant. So that'll get you really, really early in the season, the minute you can get into those soils.
It does have an amazing flavor and a great texture.
Jim,
hopefully someone that's listening can grow it and then come up with the description for the texture, because it is kind of crunchy, but not in a bad way. And I'd love for someone to give their thoughts on the texture and a good adjective for it.
Jim, was there any other things in breeding Artemis that you selected for?
Artemis is a story mostly of chasing the sweetest I could get. The parents on this, especially one of the parents, is extremely sweet. Brixing extraordinarily high, but had a whole bunch of flaws I had to fix with it. So I think Artemis is a nice happy marriage of trying to bring as much sweetness you can. That's what you expect in a cherry tomato. And so it's as close as I can get to tomato candy.
Perfect. The next variety from Jim, we're calling Loki. And this is a red slicer. It's a really nice sandwich size slicer. So it's about 6 to 8 ounces. And it has really nice firmness. But what I love most about Loki is the interior color. It's got this gorgeous red color, even when you pick it at a less mature stage. So you don't even need to let it ripen until it's soft on the vine. You can pick it pretty early and it has this amazing color. And then just like we saw with Artemis, a great disease resistance package for the high tunnel. In Loki, we see not only leaf mold, nematode, and the tobacco mosaic virus, but we also see fusarium resistance. So this is a really, really great one for an early mature, so 70 to 75 days, so nice and early for a slicer, and then a beautiful flavor.
Great.
And then last up, we have a brand new one that we are so excited about, Marzito. And this one we like to think of as a mini Marzano because it is a really awesome dual purpose small fruited variety. So Marzito is about 2 to 2.5 inches long. So you can eat it just off the plant, you know, like a cherry tomato. But it's also a nice size to slice in half and be able to make a quick sauce. But the skin is a little thinner than most cherry tomatoes, so it kind of melts if you want to make a longer stewed sauce. It doesn't kind of stick between your teeth the way sometimes if you cook a cherry tomato. So we absolutely love Marzito for its dual purpose use. And it's got an amazing rich flavor for a cherry tomato. So a little lower on the acidity side and more on some of those sugar side, sweetness and richness that you get usually with a larger fruited variety. And again, awesome disease resistance for fusarium, leaf mold, nematode, and the tobacco mosaic virus. So really, really, really excited about Marzito for this season.
I gotta say, and I don't usually say this in front of a breeder, so please, my apologies in advance, Jim, but every year when we come out with new varieties, I might have a favorite. And our new variety, my favorite this year, even though I love them all, Marzito is definitely the one that I like the most probably, simply just because it just has a really cool shape for that size. It's kind of like a large grape. And then the fact, Chenny, like you were saying, it's great to eat fresh, like you would a cherry tomato or a grape tomato, but it also holds up really nicely in cooking too. And so it's just in the flavor of it's really nice. And then something else that I just thought of, when we call these varieties out suitable for high tunnel, do they grow well outdoors as too, like in the field?
I'll throw that to Jim.
Yeah, yes, of course they do. You know, they're going to be bigger plants because they're all indeterminates. But yeah, they are suitable for outdoor and indoor, so long as you can deal with the size.
Nice, great.
Jim, so, for most of these high tunnel varieties, how are you pruning them in the high tunnel?
In the high tunnel, basically we have two primary methods. The more common is tighter spacing and pruned to just a single liter. So again, that one apical meristem can go. In our trialing for tunnels, we will try and harvest as long as we can on them, and we'll harvest every week for, I think the last trial we did had 11 weeks of harvest here. And so at that time, the plants are extremely long. They go all the way down a bench and they're leaned across the bench. So it's, I mean, gosh, they're probably close to 10 feet long or more.
Awesome.
And Marzito, I have to say, is also one of my favorites. It's between Marzito and chocolate sprinkles. So you've got good taste. And Artemis is also in that running. But
no, Artemis was good too. I know it's tricky. I'm narrowing it down to my favorite of our new varieties. I'm not saying it's my favorite variety. It's my favorite of our new varieties. And so that's also another really good point. If you want to get any information about any of our varieties, you can go to www.panamseed.com/handpicked, and they'll all be there. And then I also just wanted to note, we sell our products through distribution companies. So whoever any of you listening buy your seeds through is who you can purchase our varieties through. And Chenny and Jim, thank you very much. This has been a very, very interesting conversation, and I really appreciate your time.
Thank you, Josh.
Thanks for having us.
All right.
Hi, this is Josh from Pan American Seed Company, and I am at our High Tunnels in Elburn, Illinois. This is Artemis tomato. This is our cherry tomato that not only has fusarium, nematode, and TMV resistance, but it also has leaf mold resistance, making it a really nice choice for high tunnel production. As you can see here, they're very nice long trusses, nice bright red fruit, very, very sweet flavor, and a really nice texture as well. Hi, this is Josh with Pan American Seed Company. I'm in our High Tunnels in Elburn, Illinois, and this is our mini Marzano called Marzito. These are nice bright red fruit, about 2 inches long, 1 inch across. These work really well in a high tunnel because they have fusarium, nematode, TMV resistance, but they also have leaf mold resistance. The other nice thing about mini Marzano Marzito is that it is great as a snack type tomato, but it has a really nice texture that also makes it hold up well in cooking. Very great flavor too.
Awesome. Thank you, Josh.
Of course, of course.
It's really nice to see all the new stuff and to see Jim.
Yes.
And, you know, I really love having these things. Like when we have Novic meetings, we usually give like some time to see companies to talk about like what's new and like what they're working on. So it's really nice to see it all in one place like this.
Yeah, for sure. And oftentimes the breeders are usually busy breeding, especially in the summer. And so they're not able to be involved as much either. So it's nice to be able to hear from them too, instead of just me.
Well, you did a very good job though.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
We like you. Yeah. Okay, a couple things that came up is like, I'm thinking about it being for high tunnels and all that humidity. What about late blight? Like that wasn't mentioned as like a disease resistance, or is that an issue with this at all?
You know, we haven't seen too much late blight problems in the high tunnel. And I think maybe some of that has to do with the fact that moisture or rain, for you know, is not falling on the leaves as much or splashing up on the leaves. We do have several late blight resistant varieties, but when we've trialed them in the high tunnel, it's mainly things like leaf mold, which has to deal with the humidity or powdery mildew, that are more concerns for the foliage on those plants.
I also wanted to ask about high tunnels because I'm on the West Coast, as you know, yep. And lots of farms, and I go to the farms, I go to the high tunnels. Well, I was in Wisconsin a few years ago and walked up to the high tunnel and I was like, what is happening here? Like, because the rows were not parallel with the high tunnel. They were the other way. They were perpendicular. So, which would be me thinking like there's not a lot of airflow. And I asked the folks that were there and they're like, oh yeah, this is what everybody does. Cause that you see that a lot of times where everybody just kind of does what their neighbor does.
Of course.
But I was wondering if you've ever run into that. And it was really shocking to me.
Well, I know we have a trial in Wisconsin that we do with a high tunnel grower, and he does them parallel, like along the length of the high tunnel. I would imagine it'd be kind of hard to get around if you did it that way too, but you know, hey, if it works, then that's great. But I have not seen that.
They figured out like plant population wise, they could have more, but it was very awkward to walk because you weren't walking rows. I mean, you like walked in and it was like a wall and then you had to go around like the edges.
Do you remember, were they indeterminate plants? Like, were they really tall or were they, Because we have seen a lot of more folks who grow in high tunnels do more of the determinate varieties because that potentially, depending on where they live, gives them an opportunity to harvest in a relatively short amount of time, pull those plants out and get a crop of, you know, beets or Swiss chard or something in for Thanksgiving time.
Right.
So, yeah, but I'll keep my eyes out. I'll travel throughout Wisconsin looking for the perpendicular high tunnel growers.
Very disorienting for me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Someone said maybe it's too warm for late blight in the tunnels. Maybe. Yes.
I thought
about it right away. I also was wondering if you guys do anything with like dry farming at all with any of your tomatoes, because there's a big dry farm tomato project out here and the dry farm collaborative at OSU has been doing lots of different trials. Do you think you guys have any that would perform well as dry farmed?
Honestly, we have not trialed them under those growing circumstances. And I got to I don't know if it was 2 years ago, I guess we looked at the dry farming project at OSU, Oregon State. And no, we have not done that, but it's definitely something that we would be interested in finding out for sure.
Okay. Yeah, maybe we would contact you about that.
Yep, for sure.
I really like, I guess I was going to ask too about the blossom end rot. Is blossom end rot ever an issue or with any of these tomatoes, or are there any that are like less susceptible, you think?
I have found that oftentimes the Roma or the elongated tomatoes do tend to have blossom end rot more than like round slicers. On Marzito in particular, we have not noticed nearly as much blossom end rot as some of the other varieties, which is great. But a lot of that does depend on the watering techniques and calcium and things like that. But there's also a little bit bred into it as far as the resistance goes. And Marzito is not one that I have oftentimes seen blossom end rot. And then the other ones, I have not experienced that either, so.
Yeah, I was thinking that because I've seen it a lot on Romas, but then on cherries, you don't see it on it. And then it's kind of a blend of these two.
Exactly. No, for sure. There would definitely be potential. I can see how you would ask that question, but it is one that I have found to be pretty resistant to blossom end rot.
Well, it's very cute. I like it a lot.
And hopefully you'll get to taste it sometime really soon here because it is really, really nice tasting too. And it, like I said in the video, it's just a cool shape. It's not something that you see very often. And everyone knows there's hundreds, if not thousands of different tomato varieties out there. So to be able to have something a little bit unique and different, I think is pretty fun.
Yeah, I think so. I immediately thought of like salsa pronto, which is like the very fast, like, you know, tomato sauce that you make, and you can just do it with any kind of tomato, but it would be really good. That one too.
Yep.
And kind of more meaty than other smaller tomatoes.
Yes. You'll have to share your recipe with me and I'll try it next summer.
One thing that might be weird that I'm going to ask, but I always look at this is like the calyx. I remember you were there when we were doing a lot of cherry tomato tastings at a field day once. And I actually took the calyxes off all of them because they had been picked like the day before and some of the calyxes started to fall off and, you know, and I don't know, I wanted them to all be equal. But what does the calyx look on it when it's harvested with it? Like I really like the ones that are very like upright, you know, they're like very, and I just really think that they look very cute like that.
You've kind of stumped me. I did not pay attention to that. I will certainly do so next year. I think that it is more upright. Like just, you know, my initial thought is that it is kind of upright and cute, like you're saying.
I love that. For some reason, I've just thought, wow, does anybody, any of these breeders like select for this? Because it's, I mean, I know that they will select for like how long it stays on the trusses and all that kind of thing. And then, but I was really struck when we did that tasting and I had all these pints because I thought if a farmer had them in pints, Right. And they left the calyxes on them if that was like the easiest way for them to pick them. It look, it like drew me like appearance wise much more toward
it. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then you also have to consider like if they're bringing it to the market or wherever it's going, would those calyxes damage the other fruit in the pint too? So yeah.
It might not be the best.
Yeah, who knows though? Yeah.
I went to the market once when we did just do like that. You just took the whole truss off, you know? That was really, and I know that it's very handy, obviously, when the tomatoes stay nicely for a while on the truss.
Yep, absolutely.
Well, great. I didn't get any questions. Those are the ones we think that I was like thinking about the most. I need you to investigate the calyx and the high tunnel
orientation. Yes. You've given me a lot of work to do this summer, young lady.
Yeah, so Siri, who is a farmer up in near Seattle, she says the calyx and attachment point are very important. So there we go.
All right. I will certainly observe and get back to you.
Okay, well, it looks totally adorable. I trust you that it tastes good because you're always you're always bringing really tasty stuff to us. And I want to say I miss you.
And I miss you too. And being the last presenter, I just wanted to say really quickly, a huge, huge, huge thank you to you and all that you are doing through the Variety Showcase this past week and over the past few months. I think that now more than ever, we all need to hear about the good things going on in the vegetable world. And you do an amazing job of bringing that to us. So seriously, I am sure that I'm speaking for a lot of others. Thank you, thank you, thank you. It's really, really wonderful.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Okay, Josh, I hope to see you soon.
Yes.
And thanks for all the tomatoes because there's